Check, check, 1, 2.
Better.
Check, 1, 2.
No.
Check, check, 1, 2.
Okay.
Sure, it's a USDA.
Check, check, 1, 2, test. Much better.
The Subcommittee on Interior will come to order. Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare a recess at any time. I'm going to introduce myself for an introductory statement. Good morning. Today, the Subcommittee on the Interior will examine the Bureau of Land Management's recent difficulties with oil and gas lease sales. The Mineral Leasing Act requires the BLM to hold quarterly lease sales for oil and natural gas in states where lands are available for leasing. But it has had several lease sales canceled, either due to weather or lack of space. Congress has already provided BLM authorization to conduct online auctions instead of in-person sales through language included in the 2015 National Defense Authorization Act. The Secretary was given the authority to conduct onshore lease sales through internet-based bidding methods. BLM has already selected a vendor and conducted a pilot on-lease sales auction in 2009 when it was previously given authorization to do so through the FY 2008 Consolidated Appropriations Act. We have a video clip of some of the folks who the BLM want to ensure gets a chance to bid on these leases. Can we play the video? That is folks pretending to be hit by a car in an effort to disrupt a lease sale in Lakewood, Colorado. This is just plain crazy. To help us understand what's going on with this problem and other leasing issues at the BLM, like the coal lease sale moratorium, Director Neil Kornsey is here. Director Neil Kornsey, I appreciate you being here to answer our questions. I hope we can learn today when we can expect BLM to utilize its authority to conduct online lease sales. And with that, I'm going to acknowledge the Ms. Lawrence for her introductory statement. Thank you, Ms. Lawrence.
Good morning, and thank you, Chairman, for holding this important hearing. I thank our witness, Director Kornsey, for his time and testimony. Our discussion today will focus on the management of oil and gas lease sales by the Bureau of Land Management. Congress has entrusted this agency with the stewardship of millions of acres of public lands. The agency is capably managing grazing, recreation, and the development of natural resources on public land. For energy production, the agency is also managing public lands in Wyoming that produce the majority of the nation's coal. Solar, wind, and geothermal energy, our renewable energy sources, are also responsibly managed by the agency. During the Obama administration, the agency has approved enough drilling permits to sustain oil and gas development on public lands for the next 4 years. Some people accuse the agency of hindering oil, gas, or coal production on public land. I think the facts speak otherwise. BLM has offered over 4 million acres of land to lease for oil and gas development, but industry has only bid on a fraction of that land. Let us examine all the circumstances to see how best we can use the land that is now under energy development leases. Once that assessment is complete, it will then be appropriate to revisit the question on whether more public lands should be made available for development. I'm looking forward to this discussion. I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Lawrence. I will hold the record open for 5 legislative days for any members who would like to submit a written statement. We will now recognize our distinguished witness. I am pleased to welcome the Honorable Neil Kornsey, Director of the Bureau of Land Management at the U.S. Department of Interior. Welcome, Mr. Kornsey. Pursuant to committee rules, witnesses will be sworn in before they testify. Will you please rise and raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you. Please be seated. Let the record reflect that the witness answered in the affirmative. In order to allow time for discussion, please limit your oral testimony to 5 minutes. Your entire written statement will be made for part of the record. Mr. Kornsey, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Okay.
Thank you, Chairman. Ranking Member Lawrence, the other members of the committee, it's a pleasure to be with you today. The Bureau of Land Management manages 250 million acres of the surface of this nation and about 700 million acres of its subsurface minerals. We manage these lands under the dual framework of multiple use and sustained yield, which is a mandate from Congress, which has its 40th anniversary this year. We at the BLM take seriously our obligation under this framework to ensure the federal government's onshore energy resources, both renewable and conventional, are developed in a safe and responsible manner. Every year, we face the challenge of meeting this obligation while also moving forward with some of the most advanced and largest energy projects in the world. The BLM's oil and gas program continues to provide critical resources to our nation's energy supply. In fact, on lands where you need a BLM permit to drill, oil production has more than doubled during this administration, which outpaces production increases seen nationwide over that same time period. In FY15, onshore oil and gas royalties from federal leases exceeded $1.8 billion, approximately half of that money goes back to the states where the development occurred. Over the same period, tribal royalties exceeded $850 million, all of which went to tribal or individual Indian mineral owners. In addition to overseeing this growth in production, the BLM continues to offer leasing and drilling opportunities far in excess of industry demand. For instance, last year the BLM offered more than 4 million acres at lease sales, yet industry only bid on 15% of that acreage. Similarly, industry currently has 32 million acres under lease, an area roughly the size of Alabama. However, only 12 million of those acres, or less than 40%, are producing oil. And last year, the BLM approved more than double the number of drilling permits than there were wells drilled on the lands where they could be used. Furthermore, by the end of the year, there were nearly 4 years' worth of permits ready to drill without any additional work or review by the Bureau of Land Management. These permits have been approved and are on the shelf in the hands of industry today. Part of what we see in these important statistics is that, as is always the case, current oil prices, market conditions, and geographic considerations drive development decisions. With respect to leasing, the BLM's actions are guided by the Mineral Leasing Act, which instructs the BLM to hold quarterly lease sales in states where lands are available. In the lower 48, the leasing process starts with the public identifying parcels that they would like offered at a lease sale. The BLM decides whether to include a particular parcel in a lease sale based on allocation decisions made in applicable land use plans, our evaluation of resource conflicts, and compliance with other statutory requirements and management objectives. Once we identify those parcels that are appropriate for potential inclusion in a sale, the BLM prepares an environmental analysis in order to give the public and the BLM an opportunity to look more closely at the management considerations surrounding an individual parcel in order to inform the ultimate leasing decision on that parcel. Given the extraordinary demands placed on public lands and the resources they contain, the BLM works closely with stakeholders throughout the process to ensure that development is directed to the right places that have the fewest resource conflicts. After completing the necessary reviews, the BLM offers parcels at a lease sale. Normally, the sale schedule is announced at the beginning of the year. However, from time to time, there have to be adjustments and occasionally postponements. This happens if there are no lands available, the applicable pre-sale requirements have not been completed, or in isolated cases, unpredictable events or safety concerns justify a postponement. When an unpredictable event or safety concern prompts a postponement, all of the parcels that would have been offered at that postponed sale are offered at a subsequent sale, typically later that same year, often just a few months later. Recognizing that there are always opportunities to improve, the BLM is making important investments in our leasing process, consistent with our larger effort to modernize our oil and gas program. Notably, since receiving new permanent statutory authority, the BLM has been working to stand up an internet-based leasing system, and we intend to phase in this new process with online lease sales later this year. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. I look forward to your questions.
I thank the gentleman, and we will, because Ms. Lawrence has a markup, we will give her 5 minutes to ask questions first. So thank you very much for your testimony, Mr. Cornsey. And now, Ms. Lawrence, you are recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning, Director. The management of our energy resources is of critical importance to our national and economic security. Those resources are not replaceable once they're gone, so it makes sense that we use them in the right way and at the right time. Could you please respond to this? Do you have an estimate of the share of oil and gas produced on federal lands as compared to non-federal lands? Can you respond to that? What is our level of production?
So in terms of production on lands where you need a BLM permit to drill, it's about 7% of the nation's oil and about 11% of the nation's gas.
And it seems reasonable to me that in deciding how to best manage our non-renewing resources, we need to have clarity on the current performance. How do gas and oil prices influence bids on the oil leases and later production levels?
We see a strong correlation between prices and interest in leasing. So for instance, there's been, of course, a steep decline in oil prices recently, and we have seen a very strong drop-off in drilling and in APD applications, drilling permit applications, particularly this year. It didn't go over the cliff last year, but right now we're seeing half or a third of what we were seeing just a year ago.
So with the active current lease lands, are they producing at a high capacity, and are they contributing to our energy security?
So somewhere around 36-37% of the lands that are leased are actually being used for production. When they are producing, they're producing important revenues for the country, and we're proud to be part of that.
Okay. We have heard recent reports about a proposed cancellation in the Thompson Divide region. The concern is about inconsistent environmental standards associated with the 25 leases. Did NEPA apply at the time of the approval on the sale of these leases? And if not, why not?
So we had some procedural errors in our leasing effort there. So the short story is that the Forest Service put forward a plan for leasing, for approving potential leases in that area in the 1990s. When we went forward with leases in the aughts, we did not correctly link our analysis to the environmental analysis of the Forest Service. So they were issued with error, and the Interior Board of Land Appeals, IBLA, immediately threw out three of them that were challenged, and the rest of them continue to have difficulties. So we are going back, doing NEPA, evaluating the situation, and we're working through that process right now.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I yield back.
I thank the gentlelady. The gentleman from Arizona, Mr. Gosar, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thanks, Madam Chair. Mr. Cornsey, thank you, Mr. Cornsey, and thank you very much for getting back to me in regards for lands scheduled for disposal on the BLM. We'll look forward to the next month to seeing that up on the website. Mr. Cornsey, I'm strongly opposed to the practice used by this administration, which utilizes the Antiquities Act to unilaterally designate national monuments and to lack up millions of acres of land, BLM or otherwise, from resource development. I find it especially egregious when the administration plays fast and loose with this authority at the behest of the extremist environmentalists and special interests that do not have Americans' people's best interests in as their motives. Mr. Cornsey, Arizona already has 18 national monuments, more than any other state. Is the administration currently working on designating a new national monument in Arizona on BLM lands?
So I'm going to have to refer you to the White House. The Antiquities Act is a presidential power, And, you know, any decisions that relate to that are under the...
Oh, I understand, but have they reached out and talked to you about any types of parcels, particularly in western Arizona? No conversation whatsoever with the White House at all?
I'm going to direct you to CEQ and the White House for information on what they're working on and what they're not working on.
So the White House hasn't reached out to you one iota in regards to any lands located in Arizona?
I would say we receive requests and interest from a lot of people, from all types of stakeholders on these issues.
No, but this is a specific ask. I mean, you are under oath, and I'm asking you, did the White House or the administration talk with you or anybody underneath the BLM in regards to any withdrawal potentials utilizing the antiquities in Arizona?
I've heard discussion related to multiple possibilities.
Multiple possibilities. Can you elaborate on those multiple possibilities?
Well, I'm talking about, you know, looking at the country and figuring out where would this be appropriate, where would it not.
So there is some conversation going on between the White House and BLM and agencies in regards to antiquities withdrawal.
Yes.
That's kind of misled me. I mean, you know, at the very, very beginning of that conversation, you said you'll have to talk to the White House. So there is some coordination going on. Is there a member of Congress that actually is involved in those conversations?
Well,
remember, you're under oath.
I mean, it depends on what we're talking about. So.
Is there a member of Congress from Arizona involved in those discussions with BLM and the White House?
Is there a member of Congress involved? I mean, not that I'm aware of, but I'm going to refer you to the White House for more information on what they're working on.
My office currently has a FOIA request at the Department of Interior regarding the proposals and the coordination between land agencies and environmental groups. Will that request collaborate the information that you shared here today?
I don't know the request you're referring to, so.
The request we sent was by multiple members of Congress, was submitted on 12/3/2015, and we've received nothing of substance to date. Mm-hmm. Absolutely shameful. So much for being most transparent administration in history. Any idea when your administration will respond to that request?
I'm not familiar with that request, so I couldn't tell you.
We'll make sure that it's reissued, and we'll look for an expedited conversation. In July of last year, the House of Representatives passed an amendment to block pending national monuments throughout the country where there is significant local opposition. Do you support pursuing the designation of a monument that blatantly ignores the will of local governments and overrides every clear opposition from local communities who will be negatively targeted by such action?
So it's been a consistent position of this administration to make sure that any use of the Antiquities Act is done through community conversation, that it's responding to local interest.
So we would have a scheduled public hearing in regards to those withdrawals?
There have been public hearings before other designations. So
I'm going to be more specific about Arizona. When have those conversations occurred? Would you enlighten me?
Which?
Well, I mean, you made the comment today that there has been some conversations between the White House and your office in regards to potential liquidity of some lands. When are we expecting to have these conversations with the public out in Arizona?
I would presume if a decision is made to pursue with interest that sort of concept, that there would be a public process involved.
So you would tell me that's actually going to happen prior to, not afterwards.
That has been the practice of this administration, to make sure that there is a public process.
Can you provide for the record those that have applied prior to for the record so that we can actually have a record of that?
We sure can.
I would appreciate it. Madam Chair, I thank you very, very much for the questions.
I thank the gentleman, and I will now take my 5 minutes. Thank you, Mr. Cornsey, for joining us today. I want to start by visiting about the Coley sale moratorium. Even with the leasing moratorium in place, you and Secretary Jewell have suggested that some leases might continue and that some leasing could take place under certain circumstances. Can you provide some more assurances that some lease sales will be completed and when?
So a lot of it depends on industry interest, right? So we have, I believe, five different projects in Wyoming alone that have received records of decision or near that point in the process and are able to move forward. A very large portion of what we have on the list that can continue to move forward are projects that have essentially been approved but are sitting on the shelf because industry has asked us to pause. So there is a considerable amount of leasing that's available to move in Wyoming in addition to other states.
Now I want to shift to oil and gas. We had given you authority to do online leasing. Hopefully that would alleviate some of the concerns that you have expressed that you have to cancel meetings because the rooms are too small or the weather's too bad. You mentioned that you are moving forward this summer, but now I heard you say earlier, later this year.
Yeah.
So what does that mean? At one point I thought I'd heard it would happen this summer. Now I'm hearing later this year.
So I will clarify. We intend to have one lease sale online this summer, hope to have two or three this fall, and then if those are a success, we should be using it broadly next year.
And what is taking so long?
So I think part of it is, looking at a regulatory scheme and seeing if the authority that was given us matches with our regulations and how we thread that needle. Because there's an odd requirement for us that it be oral bidding. So we're trying to figure out how do you meld oral bidding with an online system. And then other than that, finding a contractor, getting the contract in place, putting together our rules of the road and our guidance for our team. So I can understand the desire to move faster, and we're almost there.
You have yet to make the FY15 leasing data for oil and gas public. When do you plan on releasing that data?
Let me consult with my staff. It should be very soon. Should be within the next few weeks.
As in several months?
No, I mean, next 2 weeks, let's say.
Very good. Thank you. Some state offices cover multiple states. There were only three lease sales in New Mexico, which has some very high interest areas in the Permian Basin because the Oklahoma field office had a sale. Do you have plans to ensure four quarterly sales occur in New Mexico, Montana, North Dakota, and the other states with federal oil and gas lands?
Just to make sure correct me if I don't get to the point of your question here, we are intending to move ahead with everything that's on our schedule, to the degree that we have lands that are available and the situations are, we can provide for the safety and reasonable disposition of those sales. A lot of the difficulty we've had is, adjusting to the level of public interest that's been brought to these lease sales. Historically, these have been very quiet affairs, 15, 20 people sitting together, conducting these sales. Now we oftentimes have hundreds of people attending. So we had an adjustment period through December, January, but I think Utah is a great example where we had a lease sale that was postponed in December, and we have successfully orchestrated and had that lease sale since then.
And it was postponed for what reason?
We were surprised by the level of interest. So we were under the impression there were going to be hundreds of people attending.
Was it interest by bidders, or was it interest by opposition demonstrations?
Generally demonstrators, yes.
So are you required to make those bidding sessions public?
Well, it's part of the ethos of the agency to make sure that we have as much of a public process as we can. So if folks want to attend and in a reasonable way express opinions, that's something that we welcome.
was the information made available to you earlier that there may be protests, hence that was not held, that lease sale?
Earlier, as in?
Well, you mentioned that it was postponed because you had a larger turnout, you anticipated a larger turnout, more interest, so to speak. So, in other words, were you tipped off that some protesters were going to come?
We saw press releases a day and a half in advance, and we had, in Utah, traditionally held these in our state office. And so, you know, having this kind of, having a 15-person, you know, fairly docile meeting in the midst of our employee space was something we were very used to. A day and a half in advance, being able to find a place appropriate for a few hundred people that, you know, with different levels of excitement, took us some time. So that was the reason that we postponed that sale and sought a different venue.
I just find it interesting that a traditional practice conducted in a traditional place would be changed because of a press release a couple days in advance that protesters intend to come. And protesters would have an opportunity to protest from a sidewalk, not disrupting the specific lease sale. Mm-hmm. That sounds to me like an over-accommodation of a traditional, normal process in order to accommodate a protesting group. That sounds abnormal to me.
Well, we also have abnormal security situation related to some public agencies, including ours. Right? We've had a situation where we've had militias, we've had people raising arms at different times, and we're on heightened alert, right? We're concerned about safety, and so a situation in which we're not used to separating out who's a bidder and who's not in a routine way, you know, gives us some pause and led us to take a half step back and say, how do we do this in the very near future and do it in a reasonable way that ensures the safety of everyone involved?
The leases that were non-NEPA compliant, that were Forest Service issued in the 1990s, and then subsequently you had to walk them back because of FBLA requirements, non-NEPA compliant issuances. Where were those leases? Do you remember what state they were in?
So the ones that Congressman Lawrence referred to, that was in Colorado.
And what is their current status?
So,
and let me ask first, before please. I ask about their status, had drilling begun in any of them, or were they dormant in pursuit of permitting?
So there's a range, there's about 65 different leases in Colorado that are being reviewed through this process. Some have active oil and gas production, and some have nothing. So there's the entire spectrum.
Okay, and for those where production had begun, is production continuing?
Yes.
In those where it had not begun, what is the process of reissuing them in a compliant manner?
So what is on the table right now in terms of a proposal is the Forest Service has redone their oil and gas land use plan for the White River National Forest. So they've taken a fresh look based on recent information and said, here are the areas that we think are appropriate for oil and gas, here are the ones that we don't going forward. We have, during our NEPA process, incorporated that most recent information that they provided and that they used and followed very similar lines. So places where they say, we don't think oil and gas makes sense, we've followed a similar proposal, or we've put forward a similar proposal, and in places where they have said, you know, we think oil and gas is a good use of this land, We're proposing to leave those in place. But any place where there's existing production, that production will continue.
Okay. With regard to the pilot office program, we were expecting a report on how that is going with regard to streamlining permitting approvals. That report we expected by February 1st. Do you have that report?
We are working on that. I'll be frank that we had some confusion as to which fiscal year that was desired in, and so we are doing a double quick effort to get that done and get that up to you.
I'm gonna switch topics a little bit and ask you some questions about the Wild Horse program.
Okay.
A little bit off the oil and gas topic. Both your state and mine have overpopulations of wild horses. This is a program that continues to vex those who are administering the Wild Horse program and the states that are trying to protect the quality of the range. Can you give me an update on what the status is of the program, what options you're considering that would make this program function better, especially for Wyoming and Nevada?
Yeah, well, I appreciate the question. Those two states do have the largest numbers of horses and are a serious concern. So for those that are less oriented on wild horses and burros, just as an entry-level discussion, there are about 50,000 horses on the range, 60,000 horses on the range in the West, about 50,000 that we have removed and are now in long-term holding pastures, usually in Midwestern states. Our own internal recommendation as to how many horses should be on the range is somewhere just south of 30,000, so we're nearly double what it should be range-wide. In some places, some individual spaces, it is many-fold over where it should be. So we have two difficulties here. One is that the reproductive rate is 15-20% per year. These populations can double in 3.5 years. And on the back end of the program, adoptions, which is the outlet of the program, have declined precipitously. We used to adopt out nearly 10,000 horses a year. Now we're lucky if we get 2,000 adopted. So we've a couple things that we're doing. One, we're trying to be more vocal about this, and so I appreciate asking the question. I think more public dialogue is needed. But we're very focused on birth control methods and looking at both drugs that can provide a 2-3-4-5 year window of birth control, because right now we have PZP, but PZP will only reduce the fertility for a year. And so we need a longer-term tool, because we can't get out and touch every horse every year. It's just simply not possible with the budgets that we have. So we've invested about $11 million in roughly 20 different projects, 15, 20 different projects. So we're working with USGS, we're working with big universities, trying to pull together a research program that, if we have success, it can be verified, it can be duplicated. A lot of what we've seen in the past has been smaller teams, smaller researchers, some of which couldn't be replicated. So we're taking a big science approach in hopes that we can truly find a solution on that side. We're also looking at issues of spaying and neutering. We have to be creative about what's possible. I think in the medium term, spaying and neutering horses as we spay and neuter our dogs and cats may be something that we need to do. And so we're researching that as well, and the best tools and the best ways. So that's part of our program. We're also trying to talk vocally about the actual cost of the program. Right? One of the questions that I asked my team when I joined the agency was, how much are we spending? Because the team sat with me one day and said, here are three scenarios for potential gathers next year. How many should we do? And I said, well, what's the long-term cost that comes with each one of those choices? And we didn't have an answer. It took us a while to figure out lifetime costs, but that lifetime cost is approximately $50,000, or up to $50,000 per horse over the course of its life. So that's It's a lot of money that could be invested into a lot of very important public programs. So it's important for us that we find more adopters, that we have fewer horses coming into the system, that we find some broad ways to move forward. So if you have other ideas, we are very open, and I appreciate you asking the question.
Well, thank you. It was pretty open-ended because I don't have any better ideas, so I appreciate that. And I want to thank the gentleman for indulging this lengthy discussion. The gentleman, Mr. Palmer, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. On the horse issue, I have one constituent that this is a big deal with her, and she'll be delighted that I ask about this. But does the Bureau of Land Management engage in the sale of wild horses, for instance, to Asian markets?
We do not sell outside the country that I'm aware of.
Is there a sale for meat products, dog food, things like that?
No.
So there's no sale conducted by the Bureau of Land Management? It's just a management of the herd issue?
Yeah, our focus is on, you know, making sure that there's a humane situation for the horses, that they end up with good homes.
Okay, thank you. I want to get to some of the other questions here. The Bureau of Land Management is considering implementing a rule on methane emissions. The EPA is already doing this. It seems to me that this is an unnecessary overlap. And I bring this up because prior to 2008, and I've raised this point in hearing after hearing, there were 100,000 new businesses started up each year, more than businesses that closed. Mm-hmm. 100,000 more businesses opened than closed. Since 2008, it's now 70,000 more businesses closing than opening up. We now rank 12th in the world among the industrialized nations in entrepreneurism. And one of the things that we consistently hear about, particularly with small business, is being overregulated and the complexity of the regulations and the uncertainty that it creates in trying to make a decision whether to open a business, expand a business, to invest capital. It just seems to me that if the EPA is already regulating methane emissions at the wellhead, natural gas wells, that it seems to be just adding to the regulatory burden. Can you respond to that?
So I will say that EPA does have a proposal that relates to venting. I don't believe it looks at flaring. Our regulatory approach looks at both. We've been working closely with EPA to make sure that we're not providing duplication. In fact, we have a portion of our rule that speaks to the fact that if you're meeting EPA requirements, that you can step back from requirements that we have. So, and part of what traditionally the EPA does is they look forward and say new or modified operations will follow their regulation, whereas we already have 100,000 different oil and gas wells open on public lands. So we have a regulatory responsibility there. And the bigger issue is that there are, and sort of brings all this together for us and brings the urgency, is that there's roughly $400 million worth of, you know, American energy going up in the air. You know, it's either being flared or it's being vented. So it's really a conversation about, is there a way to more productively and in reasonable fashion get more of that energy into pipelines and used in American homes? Because I believe the statistic is something, it's enough energy to power 5 million homes. So that's a loss that I'm not sure we're prepared to take. And so we're taking a look at it, and that's why we're having a public comment on our rule.
Are you applying this just on federal lands, or is this across the board?
Ours is just public lands.
Okay. Yeah. Well, the interesting thing is there's a University of Texas study that they did in collaboration with the Environmental Defense Fund that shows that the majority of the hydraulically fractured well completions, which were sampled during the study, had equipment in place that reduced methane emissions by 99%. So it appears that the technology is ahead of the curve, so to speak. And I do agree with you. One of my concerns was about the flaring, is that we're basically burning resources. I wanted to ask you also about this 20-year moratorium on coal leases that Secretary Jewell announced. Will that, do you know, I have any idea if there's an intention to apply that to oil and natural gas leases as well?
So it's a three-year pause and then a programmatic review, which mimics what was done in the Nixon administration and during the Reagan administration. I have not heard any discussion of doing something similar with oil and gas.
How about timber?
No.
All right. One of the things that I've pointed out is that the United States is literally an energy superpower.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we've only explored 15% of our offshore resources. We've got, and from what I've gotten from the Bureau of Land Management, my own research, enormous reserves of oil and natural gas, just stunning amounts. What I'd like, if you don't mind, and my time has run out here, you could respond in writing to this. I'd like, if you could, to send to my office your estimated reserves on federal lands for oil, natural gas, coal, and timber, your latest estimates on federal lands.
We'd be happy to do that.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I yield back.
I was extremely indulgent with my own time, and Mr. Palmer, I appreciate your being more timely than I was. Do you have any further questions? Okay, appreciate it very much. I have a couple follow-up questions, Mr. Cornsey, before we let you go. And thank you for appearing this morning in this abbreviated week in Congress. With regard to the BLM Permit Processing Improvement Act of 2014, how many employees has BLM hired since this became law?
Going to have to track that down for you.
Okay. I'd appreciate it. We'd love to have those numbers so we understand specifically the exact field offices where hiring of inspectors and other positions have taken place.
You bet.
So if we could have it at that level of detail, I think that would be very instructive to us as to the direction that is being taken as this law is implemented. We also are interested in the allocation of funds to each field office for the previous fiscal year and the accomplishments of each field office relating to the coordination and processing of oil and gas use authorizations. So the question being, and this is a report that I believe the agency is required to have completed. It would be helpful to us to have it completed as soon as possible or get us even some information as we go into this appropriation cycle so we can better understand the approach that you're taking with regard to human resource allocations and how this law is being implemented. Has that information been given to Interior Environment Appropes? Am I asking for redundant information or?
I don't believe we have. I mean, if this mimics the information that would come from the report that we referred to earlier, if you can provide, you know, specific data requests, you know, we might be able to get that to you, you know, in a fairly efficient manner.
Okay. Well, we will do that, and we'll ask the staff of this subcommittee to follow up with you in hopes that we can better understand as we prepare our requests to the Interior Environment Appropes Committee that we understand the allocation of human resources in these various offices and understand the manpower needs and what we hear from our constituents about whether they're being met or not. We would appreciate that very much. Thank you very much for appearing before this subcommittee today. It's an abbreviated week in Congress, and lots is going on. We're trying to cram 4 days of business into three, and consequently, everyone's running hither, thither, and yon. But your time and attention this morning is deeply appreciated by this committee. And I should probably go to whatever, see if... I guess there's no further business. The announcements were made about how members have extra time. We've asked you the questions we need to. So there is no further business. We thank you again. Without objection, the subcommittee stands adjourned.
Okay. Thank you very much.